I've been a fan of Adventure Time since the show first aired. Of course, I still love it to this day, but as an artist, I fell in love with the art style, especially the way they designed the backgrounds. In this video, I wanted to see if it's possible to create an Adventure Time style background using only Inkscape. I'll be drawing entirely with the keyboard and mouse, trying my very own background in the same style, and seeing how close I can get to the real thing. This style isn't the type you would want to use Inkscape or any other vector illustration software. It's highly detailed and involves a lot of complicated shapes and lines, so we might lose some of the finer details in the process. But I really love pushing the boundaries of what Inkscape can do for illustration, so let's see how it turns out. By the way, if you're interested in creating cartoon backgrounds with just the keyboard and mouse, I have a couple of courses on background design you might like. Right now, they are on sale. You can get these two plus all my older courses, 11 in total, at a special price. Make sure to check out the link in the description. Let's take a quick look at the elements that makes up the Adventure Time style. And here I would like to give a shout out to Channel Frederator, the animation studio behind Adventure Time, for publishing free hundreds of production works, including full HD backgrounds, on their Flickr account. Having access to these resources made things so much easier than relying on screen caps, trying to see around characters, or trying to pause videos at the right moment. I really wish more studios do the same with other shows. Anyway, let's take a look at the elements that makes up this style. First, fairly realistic geometry. While the shapes and proportions of the objects are exaggerated a bit, it's not that much compared to other cartoons. Some objects look almost as proportioned as their real-life counterparts. Regarding shapes, the show often bends and twists shapes and tend to round off harsh corners, especially man-made. This results in a nice balance between comedic cartoon humor and the more serious, darker theme explored on the show. Second, outlines, on everything. The outlines vary in thickness depending on the season, with later seasons going for thinner lines. The outlines are also colored to match the object they belong to, being of a darker value, very Disney-esque. They are also affected by shadows, appearing darker in those areas. If you really zoom in, you can also see a bit of a texture going on. There is absolutely no way I'm gonna be able to replicate this in Inkscape, so I guess this will be the first compromise I'll have to make. Third, shadows and highlights. The show usually goes for a single cel-shaded style shadow, but in more detailed areas, you'll sometimes see two layers of shadow overlapping, or even a highlight. This isn't applied to every surface, it's only on strategic places where they want more detail. If you pay attention to the production of certain shows, you'll know that some of them use vector software for their backgrounds, or even for the entire animation. However, I'm pretty sure this was not made at all with vector software. Vector software works better when you have a style that uses a limited amount of simple and geometrical shapes. The Adventure Time style leans towards more realistic shapes and detailed lighting, which can be complicated to handle using vector shapes. That does make me a bit worried about how this will turn out in Inkscape. The truth is that I haven't tried to draw in this style up until this moment, so I really got no idea how the background will turn out. And the first step in making any type of background is doing a quick thumbnail to plan ahead how the illustration will look. This step is super important and absolutely not optional. I guess I could have done the thumbnail inside of Inkscape itself, like I've done so many times before, but I thought it would be faster and more efficient to just do a quick view with pencil. I'm not sure I'm entirely satisfied with the end result. This looks a bit too generic and doesn't feel like it's saying anything. I'm gonna be 100% honest. I started this video a couple of days before the publishing date of this video, so I was in a bit of time pressure. If I had more time, I would have done at least 10 more thumbnails and picked my favorite. But here I guess this is fine. The goal of this video was to demonstrate how capable was Inkscape to replicate a style, so you don't need an amazing composition. By the way, I have no idea what is this thing. I saw a couple of statues in the background's references, and I thought it would look cool to put something like that in the back as a bit of a surprise. But it didn't work out, and I ended up changing it later in the composition. Okay, with the thumbnail done, it is time to move on to Inkscape. But before actually making the final illustration, I want to solve the colors right here and now. And also I'm gonna take this opportunity to make some quick adjustments with the help of more references. So I'm gonna start tracing over the thumbnail using very rough and simplistic shapes, so I can, in a minute, give them color and get a bit of a color thumbnail. I could have added the color in Krita when I was making the thumbnail, but I wanted to minimize the amount of work I did outside of Inkscape. Anyway, for the color I'm just sampling from the reference, and I'm adjusting by eye until everything looks nice. It is so much helpful to have the base colors that I'm gonna be using. And here it is, the finished color thumbnail, which gives me a nice pre-visualization of how the background could look once finished. And now it's finally time to go one by one, with the references by my side, replacing each shape with the final asset. I got the colors, so all I have to do is to go in and take a look at the objects in the references, and try to do something like that in my composition. Starting with this tree. I'm gonna replace this triangle with some type of foreground tree that I find in some reference. I've mentioned this in my background design courses. The goal here is not to straight away copy any particular object from the reference. Instead, you try to come up with something in the same vein to an object that you see. An instance of that type of object. That is how you really build up your visual library of cartoon objects. I love the way these subtle shadows here at the intersection really helps adding depth and giving this extra dimensionality. That is one of my favorite things about this style. It's also easy to do in Inkscape, since you can just use the opacity slider instead of changing the color of the shapes. I guess this is done in a similar way in a raster software with a right brush, but here is no problem. Making these small simple shapes that repeat in a pattern, in this case these blades of grass, it's always a pain in Inkscape, because you do have to place them manually. These types of objects are important enough that you can't use something like the spray tool to place them automatically. You have to duplicate them and place them manually, and on top you have to go one by one and modify them enough so they don't look like duplicates. It would have been so much easier to just draw them. They are such an easy and fast shape to draw, too. Throughout this background I struggled with the lines, and in these next couple of sections you'll see what I mean. The problem is that in Inkscape you make lines by drawing open paths with no fill, and the pen tool is not the most intuitive tool to make complicated lines. You see it more clearly here on the highlights on the ground, where the shape of the highlight is way more simple than in the reference. I guess if you want to be really accurate, you can do something like that, a really complex shape with tons of breaks and all, but that will result in a very slow illustration process, plus you'll end up with shapes made of tons of nodes that are really difficult to control and reuse. And the same happens here with the moss in the stones. I don't think they ended up looking bad, but if you pay attention to the real background, you see the shape of the moss is much more expressive and complicated. This is something I realized immediately as I started trying to draw in this style with Inkscape. The line and the complexity of the shapes is gonna have to take a dive if you want to make something that looks finished. And this theme of reducing the complexity of the shapes will come up over and over again in different areas of the illustration, as you'll see in a minute. With more of the composition made, I came up with the realization that having a few more stones with moss, like in the thumbnail, would look a bit too repetitive. So looking at the references, I decided to make a few bushes instead. So here I just tried to copy the style of a couple of these bushes. Once in place, you'll notice that I will start to make some duplicates and mess around with the shape, so I can save up some time instead of drawing another bush from the ground up. Making quick variations of different objects is not always possible. In the case of these bushes, I had to make so many modifications that I might as well would have redrawn them all from the ground up. But reusing parts of the illustration that you've already drawn is one of the strongest points of a vector illustration software, so you have to always be on the lookout for that. And that comes to play here with this semi-detailed back trees. I did redraw a few of them to have variation, but they are all more or less subtle variations of the same shapes, which makes them perfect for classic vector style reutilization. These trees at the left are important because they're gonna be just a little bit more detailed, working as a bit of a secondary focal point. I base this tree on one particular type of tree that appears somewhere in the middle ground in most of the references. I really wanted at least a few more or less detailed trees. Because I had to draw four of them, this resulted in an exercise in trying to reuse as much as possible. I drew a single tree, and all of the other ones were copies. I did try to make each of them as distinct as possible, going in there and manually adding and removing things, and I think the end result looks nice and it doesn't look that much like duplicates. The clouds. I'm fairly happy with the way the clouds came out. Again, just like with the bushes and with the moss, the original style has much more complicated and overlapping shapes. At this point, I had already given up with the idea of making everything as close to the original, and I just embraced the limitations of the vector shapes. So, yep, the clouds are much simpler, yet I still think I managed to capture their feeling of movement and twist. At this point, I realized that the statue will not work as the main focal point, and of course, I started to regret not spending a bit more time on the thumbnail. Anyway, I came up with the idea of using one of the mountains as the focal point and put it in the center. So I made this big, detailed mountain that I will reuse to make all the other ones, but I still thought there was something missing to separate it from all the other ones, and I decided to copy an idea from the references. I'm gonna use a cloud wrapping around it. First, I duplicated the mountains and adapted to the other shapes while making small modifications so each of them looks different enough. Making the spiral cloud was all about compromise, but I'm happy with the way it came out, and again, I feel like it just captures the feeling of the original one. The same with the other two big clouds at the bottom. I feel like I could have added more detail, but I guess that's enough. You could refine an illustration forever if you wanted. At some moment, you have to abandon it. And I think after 6 hours of drawing entirely in Inkscape, and with a wrist in pain, I was happy to end it. So here is the end result. And now that I see it all finished, I can see a million mistakes that I would like to dive into and fix, but I'm not gonna. I think it looks good enough, and while it may not get confused with a proper Adventure Time background, the whole goal of this exercise was to learn, and I think I learned a lot about how to handle more complicated styles, and fight a bit with the vector medium, and how to compromise to get the feeling of detail. After 6 or so hours working in this style, I can say that it's not a style I would go for if I had to work entirely on Inkscape, but I can certainly see some element of it that can be used to make a more medium-friendly style that is not so time and energy consuming to draw. I had a lot of fun with it, and I hope you had fun watching this video. If you like it and would like to see more of it, you can support me by giving it a like and subscribing to the channel. I do plan to make more of this type of video where I take a style and see if I can replicate it. So let me know in the comments what is the next style I should tackle with Inkscape. Also, don't forget to check out in the description the link to the special promo. Remember, it's only for a limited time. That was it for now. I really hope you had fun. See you next week. Bye!